Today I am going to speak to you about Pakistan-Ukraine relations. But before that, I must thank the rector, the pro-rector of the university and the rest of the administration of the university who have been very kind to invite us and given us this honor to be able to speak to you. As I understand, most of you understand English. And you are from different countries. I've been told there are people from 22 countries who are here to celebrate this week. Delegations from 22 different countries. So it's a great event, and I congratulate the administration of this great university to host such a big event. I'm also very grateful to the university for their hospitality, for their warmth, the typical Ukrainian warmth that they have shown to us. And I am greatly impressed by the grandeur of the university that we have come to. Now, my talk is going to be in three parts. I know that Pakistan is little known in this country. So I would first like to show, in first part of my lecture, I would like to show you a movie which will introduce you, a short movie, which will introduce you to Pakistan so that you know what is Pakistan. Pakistan is a beautiful country. You will see in this film, it's a very interesting film. And Pakistan is a very important country. We are a country of 220 million people. So it's a huge market. We have a variety of landscape. We have the highest mountains in the world. With temperatures ranging between minus 50 and plus 50 in the desert. We have a vast desert where the temperature goes as high as plus 50. And then we have beautiful green plains of Punjab, where you have greenery all around and a network of rivers and canals. Punjab, it is called Punjab, the land of five rivers. So there are five rivers which flow through this and a network of canals also. So Pakistan has all the seasons. It has beautiful summer, beautiful winter. So now I think we'll start with the movie. And in the second part of the lecture, I will speak about Pakistan-Ukraine relations. I had an option to follow my script, but I will not. I want to speak to you right from my heart. So it will be a heart-to-heart talk about Pakistan and Ukraine. And in the last, and which I think should be the most interesting part, is that I'll take questions from you, as many as you want, and I'll answer those questions. Thank you so much. We start with the film.
I can't tell you your fortune, but I can tell you where fortunes can be made. I have $1 trillion worth of minerals buried right under my soil, and coal reserves that can keep burning for 500 years. Even my salt mines are worth gold because they are second largest in the world. I have all the right connections with the world's deepest seaport, connecting to one of the world's highest roads and leading to one of the world's oldest trading routes. You can always bank on me, because my banking industry turned over 36% in profit, and my stock market was number 3 in the world. I am also the world's breadbasket, the 4th largest producer of rice, mangoes, and cotton, and the 5th largest producer of milk, sugarcane, and dates. From precision instruments that read your heart, to fabric that adorns the sleekest fashion shops, from a tiny matchstick to a roaring jet fighter, and maybe even the t-shirt you're wearing, I am everywhere. people think I'm getting old. But the truth is, I've never felt younger. My arteries are spreading and pumping with fresh blood. I'm flying higher and farther than I ever have. I'm running faster than ever. I'm filled with new energy, the passion to learn, the desire to discover, and to remain as young as ever. I am not history. I am the future. I am the home of great people. Great people who changed the course of history, and also those who define the future. Be it theoretical physics, the Higgs, or neurosurgery, the Academy Award, or the Nobel Prize, this is the home of winners. Airwomen, sportsmen, and the statesmen, all walking out of the doors of over 160,000 schools. Schools that are teeming with dreamers, thinkers, and doers. You could try guessing who I am, but you'd be wrong. I am Pakistan.
So you've had a glimpse of Pakistan. This is what Pakistan is. You've seen all kinds of terrain, all kinds of development. I reached Ukraine about 10 months back, and believe you me, I found it is one of the most beautiful countries of the world. I have traveled many countries, but Ukraine is one of the most beautiful countries. The people of Ukraine are one of the most beautiful people in the world. They are most sincere, brave people, and I must congratulate you that you have become the first democracy amongst the Russian states. You have become the first actual democracy. You have brought a common man into power. So, whether he remains here for a long time or not, but you are on road to democracy. It is the will of the people which has prevailed in Ukraine. And I think your new government is doing a wonderful job. I must also congratulate you for the exchange of prisoners that you've just had with Russia. You know, this is in the first few months of this government that this achievement has been made. So I think that under a common man, you are bound to reach the new heights of progress. And I have also observed that there are a lot of similarities between Pakistan and Ukraine. Somehow or the other, geographically, we are quite far apart, but there are a lot of similarities. I know the people of Ukraine are one of the most intelligent people. They are dominating the IT industry in Poland and in Germany. A lot of youngsters from Ukraine have gone there and they are dominating this industry in other countries. Similarly, Pakistani doctors are dominating in USA, in UK. Some of their best doctors are from Pakistan. So these are both very intelligent nations. According to some surveys, I was told by some students today that by international surveys, Pakistanis are the fourth most intelligent people in the world. And we are a nuclear power. I am sure you all know this. One of the smallest countries to be a nuclear power. We are the seventh nuclear power of the world. You have seen in this movie that we make jet aircraft. JF-17 Thunder is quite comparable with the latest aircraft of the world, like F-16 and others. You've also, and I know that Ukraine is one of the most technical states of the former Russian states. And you will be glad to know that the tanks that we need in we use in Pakistan Army, which is one of the most powerful armies of the world, is from Ukraine. T-80-UD. This is the tank made in Ukraine, and we use it in Pakistan. Pakistan is the backbone of our country. The army is the backbone of our country, and the Ukrainian tank is the backbone of our army. So we have a very good defense relationship with Ukraine. Unfortunately, on the civilian side, on the business side, our relations are quite restricted. There has just been, I think, an export of $50 million from Pakistan and more or less 100 million from Ukraine, which needs to be increased. And there is a potential. You know, Pakistan is one of the best cotton-growing countries of the world, the fourth largest cotton-growing country of the world. Our fabrics are excellent, known all over the world. We export it to America, we export it to Germany, to France, to UK. Somehow or the other, it is exported very little into Ukraine. We need to increase this export. Then rice, one of the finest rice in the world, the fragrant rice, you can smell it. It grows in Pakistan, but I don't see much of it in Ukraine. The mangoes, if any one of you who has happened to taste the mango of Pakistan, he or she will not like to have a mango from anywhere else in the world. It is so fragrant and it is so tasteful. So we produce one of the best fruits in the world. And from Ukraine, I know you have a lot of steel. And the steel industry that was set up in Pakistan by Russia in those days, the USSR. I heard that mainly the engineers were from Ukraine. So Ukraine has a very big steel industry. And we need a lot of steel in Pakistan. There are people who would like to buy steel from here, but somehow or the other, it is not being exported to Pakistan. So there is a lot of potential of business between the two countries. We need to exploit this potential. Then there are medical instruments and the beauty instruments which are made in Pakistan, a place called Sialkot. They are exported throughout the world, throughout the European world, UK, USA, France, but somehow or the other, their export to Ukraine is restricted. I think there is somebody who should take this step and import these instruments here. Then about the football. You know, 70 to 80% of the footballs being played in the world are produced in Pakistan. And every year, the football with which the FIFA Cup is played is from Pakistan. So Pakistan is very good at sports. We have been the champions in cricket in 1992. And incidentally, our present Prime Minister, Mr. Imran Khan, was the captain of that team in 1992. He is a sportsman turned politician. Like you have a Prime Minister, actor turned politician. So this is another similarity. I wish they both meet and they exchange notes and they can bring these two countries closer together. They are both charismatic, loved by the people. People remember, you know, Imran Khan is known throughout the world. There are some people who know Pakistan just because of Imran Khan, because they know who's Imran Khan. He has been the best cricketer of the world in 1992. So this is the kind of sports that we have. We have one man, Jahangir Khan, who plays squash, and he won the world championship 12 times. At stretch, 12 times, and it is a Guinness Book of Record. So we have that stature of sportsmen in Pakistan. Very talented nation. I wish that these two nations collaborate, they get together in some of the fields, and they can do miracles. So my aim is to increase this interaction between the two countries as an ambassador. I was telling somebody that I'll be here for 2-3 years and be the ambassador of Pakistan in Ukraine. But for rest of my life, I am going to be the ambassador of Ukraine in Pakistan. I will speak of Ukraine in Pakistan. I will speak of the interest of Ukraine in Pakistan. So my aim and objective is to increase the interaction between Pakistan and Ukraine. I was also very dejected to learn that we have just two students from Pakistan in this university. You know, I would like to have at least 2,000 students from Pakistan. And I know the education here is too good. This is a beautiful university. I have just seen the facilities that you have. They are world-class facilities. So we would like more Pakistani students to come here. I also had paid a short visit to the medical university here, which is also one of the best universities. And there are 36 Pakistani students who are studying there. Some of them are sitting here also. I am glad they are here. So there also, my wish is to increase the figure. Totally, we have about 300 students from Pakistan studying in Ukraine. We need to increase them at least to 5,000. You know, this is the base. The students' interaction at student level will result in an overall development and cooperation between the two countries. My effort is there. I will make all my best efforts to increase this number, to increase the import and export between Pakistan and Ukraine. Then, politically, we are passing through a similar situation. You know, I just talked of the prisoners and congratulated you for exchange of prisoners with Russia. I know that a big chunk of your land is under the Russian occupation. Similarly, a big chunk of Pakistan's land is under the occupation of India, Indian occupied Kashmir. And I would like to highlight today the humanitarian catastrophe which is taking place in Indian occupied Kashmir. Today is the 39th day of curfew clamped in Indian occupied Kashmir. People have run out of food in their houses because they can't come out. The shops have run out of stocks. They are not getting medicines. They are not getting life-saving medicines.
Somehow the other, geographically, we are quite far apart. But there are a lot of similarities.
They are not being paid any attention. And it has become the biggest jail of the world. There are 800,000 people who are under this siege, 800,000. 6,000 youngsters have been arrested from their houses and have been shipped to the other parts of India. And they are being tortured, they are being harassed, women are being raped, rape is being used as a weapon of war. For a moment, let me say that it is not our part, it is India's part. Do you treat your own people like this? Who would like, which country which boasts to be the biggest democracy in the world would treat their people with this, you know, with this attitude? These atrocities, you might have seen films on the internet. This is mind-boggling. So we, as the independent citizens of the world, wherever we are, we need to raise our voice on the basis of principle. Forget about Pakistan and India, but where is the humanity? We all need to raise our voice to question India's atrocities in Indian held Kashmir. That's a nation which has given a sacrifice of lives.
This is the land made in Ukraine, and we use it in Pakistan.
I would also like to tell you about a development in the Human Rights Council of United Nations. Their chairperson has given a very strong call to India to relieve this 39 days old curfew in Pakistan. There has been a voting, and 58 independent minded countries have given a vote urging India to lift this curfew, this 1.5 month old curfew from Indian occupied Kashmir. And none of you, none would understand better than you, because you are yourself going through such things, that what is the implication of being subjugated by a foreign land. Let me also tell you that India and Pakistan are two nuclear powers sitting eyeball to eyeball with each other. And if these atrocities do not cease, then there is a great danger of a nuclear war between the two countries. And what, and who knows better than you? We just had an accident, nuclear accident in Chernobyl, and the effects are even visible today. And you know what happened in Hiroshima and Nagasaki? Only one tiny bomb was dropped in Hiroshima and one in Nagasaki. And people are being born crippled even today. And the whole cities were razed to ground. What happens if in this modern era the two nuclear states go to war with each other? The effect will not be restricted to India and Pakistan. Nothing will grow in complete Europe for the next about 50 years. Such is the side effect of the nuclear war. So we all need to make an effort to stop these countries from going to war. Pakistan has been consistently saying that we want to talk. You know, after every war, after the World War I, World War II, they all went to the table. League of Nations came up after the First World War. The United Nations came into being after the Second World War. So every problem, ultimately, if after having fought the most fierce war, you have to go to the table. So why not go to the table now? Why not decide things on the table? We would love to do that. The Prime Minister of Pakistan has declared many times that if India moves one step towards peace, I will move two steps towards them. So this is our stance. We are a peace-loving country, but prepared for war. Why we are prepared for war? Because we are not going to accept the hegemony, like you are not accepting the hegemony of Russia. You are a small country, but you're not accepting it. So we are not accepting hegemony of any other country. We want to talk on principles, and we want to have a peaceful world. We want to contribute to the peaceful world. We have already contributed. You know, this peace force, this United Nations peace force, the major contributor is Pakistan. I think the number of troops that Pakistan contributes to this force is more than any other country in the world. So we are a peace-loving country. We don't want to have war. We want to have development. We want to work for the humanity. So I would urge that Ukraine and Pakistan join hand, and we both strive for peaceful countries. We both strive for development. We work together. We are intelligent nations. We can develop many, many things together. We can add to each other's business. We both have economic problems, so we can solve each other's problems. We can indulge into export. Pakistan is good at education. Lot of people from Ukraine can go to Pakistan and study. And lot of people can come from Pakistan and study here, because I know these studies are very good. This university, I was surprised, a very pleasant surprise, that there are 12,000 students in this university. There are 1,000 staff teaching here. So it's a huge university. By any standards, it's a world-class university. So why not that we make use of this? Pakistan should also make use of this. English is a bit of a problem. I know the younger generation of Ukraine can all speak English, because if you want to become an international player, you have to learn other languages. A lot of youngsters are learning. And Pakistan is a place where our official language and our medium of instruction is English. So anybody who goes there can learn good English. And they are very hospitable people. You will love it. During my tenure, I sent one of your ski teams to Pakistan to participate in the ski competition. And they won the second position. There were four girls who went, and they did excellent. So this interaction needs to increase. We need to increase the interaction between the two countries. And I'm sure we will stand together for peace, we'll stand together for development, for progress.